Welcome back, friends. Let us move on to our next technical session. In this technical session, we are going to understand overview of auditing standards with emphasis on SA 701, communicating key audit matters in the independent auditor's report. To share knowledge in this session, we have two eminent speakers. As a chairman for this session, CA Nityananda sir. As a speaker, CA Srinivas K.P. We request our brand chairman to escort the speakers and the chairman onto the dais. We also welcome them to the floor, okay? Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the chairman to the session. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the speaker. Thank you, chairman. Friends, it is my pleasure to introduce the session chairman, CN Nityananda. CA Nityananda graduate in commerce and law is the university first and gold medalist in business administration. Presently, he is the director of Central Bank of India and also chairman of its audit committee and member of other committees. He is also on the state advisory committee of Controller and Auditor General Office. He is a director on the board of Federation of Karnataka Chamber of Commerce and Industry and is the chairman of its committee on Central Taxes and Corporate Laws and GST Committee. He was the chairman of Bangalore branch of SARC in 1987 and the SARC in the year 1992. He was the Central Council member, New Delhi, from 1995 to 2004, three terms, and was a chairman of Auditing and Assurance Standards Board and Board of Studies and Vice Chairman of Accounting Standard Board. He has wide experience in professions spanning over 39 years and has rich experience in corporate consultancy and assurance services. He is a member of board of several companies and was the chairman of Auditing Committee of BGSE Financials Limited. He was also a member of Audit Committee of the Karnataka State Cricket Association. He has been a guest speaker of ICAI, ICWAI, ICSI, IIM Bangalore, and Bangalore University, Karnataka Bureau of Public Enterprises, CNAG's office, and Direct Taxes Regional Trainings Institute. He is guest faculty at National Direct Taxes Academy, Nagpur, which trains all Indian Revenue Services officials of the Income Tax Department. He is a regular columnist in Kannada leading newspaper Vijayawani. He has travelled widely across the globe and has been a speaker at an international conference at Italy and chairman of sessions in corporate governance at Karachi, Pakistan. He has represented India at the meetings of International Federation of Accountants at New York, USA. He is a life member of Red Cross Society and he is involved with various charitable activities for the past three decades. With this, more than that, a fascinating individual. With this brief introduction, I present CA Nityananda before you. Please join me in pleasure to introduce our speakers to this session. CA K.P. Srinivas, a fellow chartered accountant, a diploma in information systems audit from ICAI, partner of Verma & Verma Chartered Accountants Bangalore. In the profession for over 19 years of experience, his experience in corporate audit and taxation, he has conducted training programs for corporates on various professional subjects such as taxation, corporate law and accounting, served on the expert committee of Bangalore Chamber of Commerce and Industry, an active participant in the professional development and continuing education program of ICAI. With this brief introduction, I present CA K.P. Srinivas. Please welcome.
At the outset, I'm extremely happy to be a student today, so that I can learn a little more on the auditing standards. That's all here. Basic concern as well as the institute and the profession, in my view. See, you may become a major consultant for mergers and acquisition. You may be a consultant for international taxation. Or you may be a very big counsel in NCLT. And you may earn much more than what you do as an auditor. But the basic recognition of this profession, whether in the public view or from the regulator's angle, this profession is considered because of its auditing skills. I mean, whether you like it or not, basically, I mean, you are considered as an auditor, and once the auditor gives a report, his signature is there on the financial statements. I mean, public have that amount of confidence that everything is fine and hunky-dory. So why I am mentioning this is, whenever you have a program on auditing standards, the numbers, I mean, say it all on it. Okay. The branch will have to have this partition in between. I am sorry to say this, but fact is, there is no enthusiasm as far as the auditing, to learn auditing standards. I mean, one is, yes, the modern gadgets are available. You can sit wherever you are, in your mobile, in your tab, in your laptops, you can go through the standards. But at the same time, nothing like learning in a workshop module, because we can always exchange lots of experiences what each one have experienced in auditing. Because whenever the regulators ask, or whenever various agencies start probing for some failures in corporate governance, I mean, the auditor also is sort of questioned a lot, the statutory auditor and the internal auditor. And then the technical standards, I mean, those auditors and those firms who have followed the technical standards and they have done the proper evidences they have gathered, they got proper representations, their audit files are complete, I mean, they need not have to fear at all. I mean, but if there is a gap between what has been done with all the good intention, but the files do not speak of what has been done with all the effort, I mean, there's a lot of problem in store for the profession. I'm not being negative, but I am being very frank in the situation, because I have participated in n number of disciplinary proceedings, n number of interactions with the regulators. So this is where, I mean, the gap is. So there is somehow a need for the branches and for the entire institute as a whole to bring all these knowledge exercises and auditing standards more and more nearer to the members. I had the occasion of going to at least more than half a dozen tier 2, tier 3 cities. Somewhere in Rajasthan, somewhere in Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra. Basically, I was speaking, seminars were basically on the tax audit. And my goal, this one was not only on the income recognition and computation standards, but also I've been linking it with the auditing standards. What all auditing standards we have to follow while doing the tax audit? I mean, the gaps were very, very evident and quite large, I should say that. ASP, of course, under Mr. Shyamala Agarwalji, the present chairman, and Mr. Naveen Gupta, lots of projects are going on, because I had told the chairman to propagate like what are the projects which are going on and who are all interested across the country. They can join in those projects. Very interesting projects are on. Right now we have completed the project on the real estate accounting, real estate investment trust, auditing of that has been completed. The election commission wants a accounting or auditing for political parties, a difficult exercise indeed, but a needed one. Then on the urban cooperative banks, a project is on, and also the revision of the general insurance and life insurance audits, that is also underway. Today, of course, Srinivas will be highlighting on various auditing standards and more particularly on the SCA 701. Basically, I mean, you may do the audit taking lots of time, lots of efforts, but finally, the communication is only through our report. I mean, if our report highlights the various issues which are key audit matters, then I mean the stakeholders can appreciate the role of the profession more. If by chance the report is not really communicating what it should on key matters, then I feel that we fail the whole exercise. I mean the efforts may be there, but in the final, this one, it's like always my teacher in auditing in my college used to mention, you may study even 3 hours, 3 months for your examination. But unless, I mean, you write your examination well and communicate with the examiner what you want to, the answers, I mean, you don't really succeed. So, similar way, unless, I mean, through this report, we don't communicate the key matters to the stakeholders, I mean, the whole exercise, I mean, comes to a naught. So, I am more here as a student of auditing standards. I look forward to a very good knowledge exercise in this technical session. Over to you, Mr. Srinivas. Thank you.
Let me thank the branch management for having given me the opportunity to present this paper on talk on auditing standard on SA 701. Even more thankful because I am speaking in front of a session which is chaired by a very senior person, very senior professional, Nityananda ji, whom we have always seen as a role model as we grew up, as we attended seminars like this when we were students or freshly qualified chartered accountants. So it is that approach that he concluded in his talk, saying that all of us are students, and then he mentioned that he is so humble enough to mention that he himself is a student still trying to learn. And then, so as part of that approach and then as part of that legacy that we all have to always be aware that there are things that always we need to learn, we have to be students. More so when we are talking about a topic like 701, this is being implemented for the first time, or this is a new standard which has evolved over a period of time and it has become applicable for the first time now. But at the same time, why there is a requirement of this standard or something like this? So, going back to brief history, like what was highlighted by Nityananda ji and then also in the earlier discussions, the audit process is a very long or lengthy process. It may involve several people, it may involve several hours of time, it may involve several documents that has been inspected, it may involve several ledgers or analysis being done, but finally where does it end? And then how does the person who is reading the report will come to know what has gone into an audit? When you read, when the present reports that we read from looking at the auditor's report, it is not easy to gauge what has gone into the report or what has gone into the audit. So this 701 is basically trying to bridge that communication gap so that the auditor has an opportunity, or auditor is bound under a duty to report what are the key audit matters. So with this brief background, let us get into the presentation. To give an overall background, it is not just that this 701 has been introduced. 701, he is coming with other changes to some of the other relevant or the other auditing standards which has an interplay. So it has basically the standards on auditing which has undergone a change. Report on the reporting standards. The reporting standards which have undergone a change are 700, which is basically the standard on issuing of reports, then 705 and 706, which a modified opinion or an emphasis of matter has to be included, or in respect of other standards like 570, though all the standards were revised effective from 1470, the requirements under 700, 705 and 706, that is the audit report format, got extended by a year. That is why we are looking at the standard 700, 705 and 706 along with 701 only now. Otherwise the 570, which is on the going concern, was amended in the previous year itself and it is already effective for the periods ending March 18. Also, one of the other key standard which got revised as part of this whole standard is the SA 260, which talks about communications with the management. So to get an overall understanding of how the reporting has progressed in the past 1 year or how it will be in the future, a good understanding of all these five standards will become necessary. 700, 701, 705, 706, 570 and 260. So, but the presentation now here I am trying to focus on 701, but however wherever there is an interplay with the other standards, how the other standards will have to be considered when the reporting requirements under 701 is done, I have relevant places I have discussed those standards also. The auditors have only their auditors report to communicate with all the stakeholders, be it shareholders or directors or not directors, or the other stakeholders, the government agencies or the other who are interested in these reports. Audit report is the only way of communicating with them. So now there is a big change in the way that these auditors' reports will be presented. So as part of this change, the auditor's opinion, which is the most important thing in any auditor's report, is to be done first. Earlier that used to be the last item in an auditor's report. After going through 3 pages or 2 pages, at the end we used to give our opinion saying that in our opinion the balance sheet represents a true and fair view. Now this is required to be given upfront. So that is a big change from the way that we are trying to communicate with the stakeholders. And after the opinion paragraph, that is the opinion is given, then we come to the basis of opinion paragraph. Then after that, the next para is on material uncertainty relating to going concern. This is where a major change has happened in respect of reporting on issues relating to going concern. Because going concern, everyone is grappling with going concern issues, the companies, the auditors, the financiers or the bankers, or the regulators, everyone want to know what's happening and then whether the company will be a going concern. So earlier the requirement under 570 was to report going concern matters under emphasis of matter, if it is not merely matter of emphasis. But now they have segregated a separate section altogether in the auditor's report. That it has to be reported in a separate category, a separate heading called material uncertainty related to going concern. So after this is where the key audit matters will get reported, and after this the other matters come up, where the management's responsibility for the financial statements will be detailed and the auditor's responsibility for the financial statements will be detailed. The auditor's responsibility for financial statements also have undergone a sea change in the content of the that particular paragraph. And then of course there are other matters, report on other legal and regulatory requirements. So as you can see, the auditor's reports have been turned around, where it starts with the opinion para, then the basis for opinion, then going concern, then key audit matters, then the responsibility para. So this will take some time for us to get used to the way the audit report is being formed, is formatted and then being communicated. And this is in line with the international standards on auditing, which some of the other countries have already implemented it. for past 2 years, if I'm right. In some countries, I implemented for past 1 year. And then India will be implementing from April 18 onwards. So the first report would be in respect of the interim financial results, which some of the companies would be getting audited and released, or most of them will be doing at least March 19, being the year. Year end, it will be applicable for the first time. As far as key audit matters is concerned, this is expected to be mandatory applicable only for the listed entities. So, though the other amendments of the format of the report and the other amendments to modified report and emphasis of matter is applicable for all the entities, the key audit matters is applicable only for listed entities. Where they are listed, it is applicable only for such entities. Also, it can be mandated by law. If it is mandated by law, then also it will be required to be disclosed. As of now, I don't think there is any law which has amended to say that key audit matters have to be included, but for a period of time, each law can prescribe whether key audit matters have to be included in the report. Also, it is applicable in all circumstances for a listed company. However, if the auditor decides and then uses a disclaimer of opinion, then key audit matters loses its relevance and it is not required. Because the auditor is not expressing any opinion, there is no point in discussing only on particular matters. So, the key audit matters is not required when a disclaimer of opinion is expressed. And what is the purpose of key audit matters? The key audit, the purpose is mainly to enhance the communicative value so that the person reading the key audit matters paragraph will be able to better understand what are the key audit matters that have gone into this particular audit, and then provides greater transparency about the audit that was performed. So the auditor here, depending on the issues that he is reporting, will use this opportunity also to present various other matters, various matters which in the normal course would not have been possible in the regular audit report. Then it also provides as a basis of providing additional information to the shareholders or to the other stakeholders of the financial statement. In particular, it will also provide lot more information on the matters which on which the management has exercised judgment, or the management has relied on external experts, and these are the matters on which the auditor also will have to express his judgment on the aspects on which management has exercised their judgment. And then this assists also in understanding the entity better and then areas of significant management judgment. So this is one particular section which may differentiate reports of one company from the other, because it will be specific to a particular company. So the standard
which are the general key audit matters?
Yeah, we'll come through that. I'll be taking through that. We'll discuss what are the typical key audit matters which will be presented. The definition of key audit matters as per SA 701, it reads that those matters that in the auditor's professional judgment were of most significance in the audit of the financial statements of the current period. Key audit matters are selected from matters communicated with those charged with governance. So essentially these are matters considered by the auditor as very important, but which did not result in a modified opinion. In the present format of the auditor's report, only if there is a modification of the auditor's report, additional paras are reported. Some information about the company gets reported if there is and modification of the auditor's report. Otherwise, the report is very standard. We cannot differentiate the independent auditor's opinion between one company and the other company. And the key audit matters involves reporting of some of the key aspects that the auditor has found. But at the same time, just because you have reported something under key audit matters will not absolve you from modifying opinion if required. So it is not a substitute for disclosures in the financial statements that require management to make or that are otherwise necessary to achieve fair representation. So key audit matters are something which are over and above what is actually required in the financial statement. So just because the auditor has reported in the financial statements does not mean that the financial statements need not carry that information. If as per the requirement of the auditing standard, accounting standard, some disclosure is required, then the company or the management will have to make those disclosures in the financial statements. And then it is not a substitute for expressing a modified opinion when required by the circumstances of a specific audit. So just because you have reported under the key audit matters, the auditor is not absolved from qualification if the situation calls for qualification. And then it is not a substitute for commenting on the going concern if there is an issue related to going concern. And it is not an opinion on individual matters. For example, if the auditor decides that inventory is a key management, key audit matter, and then he reports on inventory in the key audit matter, that does not mean that he is expressing opinion on the inventory. His expression of opinion is on the balance sheet as a whole and not for each item that he is covering in the key audit matters. So this is very important to understand that when a key audit matter is presented, the auditor is not expressing opinion on the particular aspect or particular line item in the balance sheet. And the standard requires that key audit matters have to be given under a subject heading in the audit report, as we discussed earlier, that it has to be presented under a subject heading. And also, the auditor will have to also give the reasons why he has selected a particular item as key audit matter. And then also, how he has dealt with things in his auditor's report, or how he has dealt with his audit has to be mentioned. And then also, he has to relate or refer to the management's perspective or the disclosures in the financial statement. For example, if the key audit matter includes a matter relating to sundry debtors or trade receivables, then if the management has already given extensive disclosures in the financial statements, then the auditor is required to refer to the relevant disclosures where the, for example, if it's a trade receivable, where the trade receivable matters are being discussed.
In that case, is it relevant? Is it necessary when the disclosure is made in the management representation?
Yeah.
Whether it is a requirement to mention it in key audit.
Yeah, if the auditor decides that trade receivables, area of trade receivables is a key audit matter, then he has to report it under key audit matter. And then he will have to refer to what the management what management has been reported in the financial statements. He has to do.
So if they are going by line in line, then whether it is again necessary. What management is disclosing,
yeah,
is fair enough. Again, is it necessary to disclose in key audit matter?
Yeah, it is required if he decides that it is a key audit matter. If he decides that it is not a key audit matter, then he may not discuss. It depends on the complexities involved, or if there are a lot of uncertainties involved, or if there are a lot of estimations involved, then he will discuss about receivables if there is uncertainty or other things. So there will be a reason why he will be discussing it as a key audit.
And these reasons also need to be highlighted, right? Why he comes to
exactly.
So generally,
if he is in agreement only, he will report under key audit matters. If he is not in agreement, then he will have to decide whether he will give a modified opinion or he will give a disclaimer opinion or adverse opinion. These are matters which he is agreeing, but he will have to go through the, but since he has gone through a whole process of the audit, he will disclose that in the audit. So, later part of the presentation has certain illustrations, so that it will become a lot more clearer of these matters. This is what the key audit matters does not mean that it has not been properly dealt with. It is just that the auditor has identified this matter as a key audit matter. So it should not include matters which are unresolved, or the auditor does not accept, or auditor does not subscribe to what the management has done, or it cannot be a circumstance where he should have emphasized that, or he should have modified the opinion. So such matters cannot be part of only key audit matters. So on the key audit matters, he should be careful with the language that he uses. He cannot use very generic language or a standard language. He has to be specific to the company. For example, if it is relating to say foreign exchange losses, if the matter is arising from standard foreign exchange matters, that everyone will understand that there could be issues on certain companies, that the forex will have a serious impact on certain things. But instead of writing very generally, you should write how it is impacting the company. So the language has to be more specific to the company, not a very broad matter.
So what if he disagrees, let's say it's a particular key audit matter, some provisioning, but it doesn't affect his opinion of the overall materiality of the balance sheet and payment. So I could disagree on a particular topic, but okay, overall the balance sheet can still show true and fair. So in which case, how does
so then it may not be a key audit matter if it is not material.
Okay.
Because there could be several matters which will come up during an audit. There could be 10 or 15 items which auditor identifies to communicate with the management, but of which only 2 or 3 or 4 could be key audit matters. So there could be, this is always supposed to be a subset of the total matters that has been taken up before the management or the board of directors.
This is addressed to the board of
directors. The key audit matters is part of the auditor's report, which is addressed to the shareholders.
No, but an interesting point which he made was,
yeah,
you are picking it out of the management report.
Yes.
So, you should first figure in the management report.
Yes.
And from there you take it out and put it in the...
That is issued to the management, the board of directors or the audit committee.
Audit committee. So,
yeah, definitely.
If you are not, suppose you are not made a report to the management.
The standard does not allow such matters without communication with the people involved in charge.
So they modified that standard, is it? Okay. SA 260 they have modified.
Yeah, they have modified. Definitely they have modified.
And that they have done for 1/4/2017.
SA 260 has been modified with 1/4.
So that means,
there is a requirement to inform the client, the board of directors, what are the key audit, what are the audit issues.
For this year onwards?
Yeah, 17 onwards it is applicable.
Okay. So does it apply to listed companies only?
Yes, no, it will apply to everyone. 270 will apply to everyone. What comes into the auditor's report is only for listed companies.
No, because everybody has signed off, 5th September they have completed audit. what they communicate?
See, this overall, all these 6 standards were supposed to be applicable from 17.
Huh.
They deferred only these 3-4 standards to 18.
Okay.
But they remain to be effective from 17.
1/4/2017.
So that is why you see that lot of reports which carry this going concern has this new para in it. Yeah.
See, for example, balance sheet, trade receivable, credit books, performance guarantee bank, buying advance given by the companies of people. In the course of the year, they have got completed and they have retained buying. Not the directors report to the payable to the state about this 5%.
So no, I think it's not very audible. They can be given in my
mind. Well, question is now, they say 260 communication with the management.
Yeah.
Does it apply to the branch auditor also?
Yes.
So all the bank auditors are required to give a SA 260 communication?
Definitely. Because as part of planning itself, the audit is supposed to communicate to the board of directors that this is our plan, these are the likely key audit matters or matters which will be considered for key audit matters. So it starts at the planning stage itself. So then there is an occasion for the management also to take initiative and then start discussing at the planning stage itself.
See,
trade
reserves, 100 crores. Then during the course of the year, company has given performance guarantee, 3 crores. And the same has been engaged by the body. This matter did not specifically appear in the auditor director's report. What auditor has to do? Yes, one of this performance bank guarantee has been engaged and there is a remote viability of its trading bank. So it's a key matter how auditor has to report.
See, here the facts whether the accounts have been fairly prepared has to first be very clear. If 3 crore rupee performance guarantee being invoked is very material for the balance sheet and that has not been properly dealt with by making appropriate approval, then it is a matter which may require modification of the auditor's report, saying that caution for bank guarantee or the likely losses.
No, auditing can show the key audit matters.
No, no, if it is a matter to be modified, he has to qualify the opinion, it has to be qualified. By putting it key audit matters, the auditor will not be absorbed. He will not be absorbed. This is over and above the present requirements of identifying matters which will affect materiality or true and fair. They have to be qualified. Or there could be an occasion they have to issue an adverse report, they'll issue an adverse report. But just because something has been reported under key audit matters does not mean that it can be a matter for qualification.
No, but
it will not be brought under key audit matters. But it will be brought under modified opinion. I will go through the illustrative format which the institute has prescribed, that if you have qualified opinion, how to draft the particular note. If you have disclaimer, if you have, for example, material uncertainty related to going concern, how do you draft the key audit matters? I have brought out the illustrative format of what institute has prescribed, that also will go through. So when the key audit matters have been drafted, one is to bring out the facts why that was considered as a key audit matter. Then also to discuss in detail what audit procedures have been adopted by the auditor to see that the audit evidence is obtained regarding audit assertions required. By doing that, the auditor is not expressing an opinion on the particular line item. If he is looking at impairment analysis as a key audit matter and then he has gone through the process of assessing external experts' document valuation or internal valuation done or projections done, if he is going through the whole process of the parameters that he is checking for the discounting or forecasting, that does not mean that he is expressing an opinion that that impairment valuation is correct or not. He is doing that only to satisfy that it gives an adequate audit evidence. That is the only limited purpose. So in other words, by putting the key audit matters a point, auditor is not undertaking or doing anything extra. That is very important. He is not undertaking an extra activity to report on goodwill impairment. Goodwill impairment testing, he has done it based on his risk analysis that it is an important risk item, so he has identified that as an item for audit verification or audit review. Then based on that, he has gone through the process what the management has adopted, he has gone through the external reports, and then if required, he may ask his own internal experts to look at it. But all this is doing as part of the audit that he is supposed to do. He is not doing just because there is a requirement under KA. So this is very fundamentally that we need to understand, that this is not an additional obligation cast on the auditor. The additional obligation is only to report or communicate. He is not doing anything extra here other than what he is doing under the normal audit.
What is the objective, like who is actually benefited out of this? Is it auditor who gets benefited, or is it the...
See, as we discussed, the benefits are multifold actually, to look at it. One, there is always a thinking, there is always a allegation that auditor's report does not say anything. Every report says true and fair, varying for few words, wording differences, unless it's a modified opinion. All auditors' report looks the same. But there is always this increasing feeling that auditors have not communicated or not mentioned the issues. And to this extent, every audit will pass through, at least a listed company audit will pass through significant efforts on specific matters. So this is a proper way of putting across how the audit process went through. For example, it could be an impairment analysis, or it could be a financial instrument related evaluation, or it could be inventory, or it could be accounting for subsidiaries, or it could be forex issues. Whatever issues are there, this key audit matters will throw out or will be used to communicate that this is the process that they have gone through. So if someone reading the key audit matter will be able to understand that the auditor has gone through this process, and then based on this process only he has given his views. So in the previous presentation we actually saw what an audit process is about, where there are interactions between the audit team, where there are interactions between the audit team members and the company, and within the company also they are interacting. And many of this could be oral, many of this could be in the form of reports, or many of this could be in the form of emails. So this key audit matters. If it's a key audit matter, you will have to be very sure that you have communicated all these matters to them, and then you have adopted all the audit procedures which are relevant for this purpose, and you have obtained the audit evidence, then it means that you have followed the full audit process. So for example, if it was a scenario like the morning example that we saw, the auditor's report in the current context, if they are not qualifying, for example in one quarter they don't qualify and then they have to issue an auditor's report, the audit report will clearly state the entire process of this impairment, about these various assets, how the cash flows from each assets have been evaluated, what are the major parameters for each of those assets, and then who has, whether it was done internally, externally. So all this matters, about 8 or 10 points on the whole way that the management has evaluated, will form part of the key audit note, what the management has done. And then also how the auditor has challenged it, how the auditor has verified it. The auditor normally will look at whether in a similar circumstances how other companies would have done, or he will look at it how the previous years were done, or he will look at the same forecast with the forecast which the company is doing for other purposes, whether the forecast given for impairment testing is the same as which the management has approved or the board has approved, or the parameters which they obtained last year, whether they have changed it significantly this year, or they said that for this particular year we'll be growing at so and so level, but actually they have not grown so much. So these are various ways in which the auditor will have to challenge or test whatever management estimates are given, or if the management has relied on an external expert, then they have to challenge those parameters in terms of forex rates they have used, or the interest rates they have used, or the period which they are forecasting. So there are various parameters which are critical for any estimate or valuation. So the audit here has an opportunity of not only review, going through all this, but putting across in the key audit matter. So, but after doing all this, if he draws a wrong conclusion, then it will be very apparent in the key audit matters that he has reported. So, but it becomes a lot more transparent. For example, in the banking audit, the auditor probably will look at the provisioning norms as a key audit matter, or valuation of investments.
This would be in addition to the LFA or whatever.
Yeah. This will be definitely in addition to the LFA. But this will apply only if the report is issued under the standard. See, this is the illustrative introductory para which the institute has given, or the standard says, key audit matters are those matters that, in our professional judgment, were of most significance in our audit of the financial statements of the current period. These matters were addressed in the context of our audit of the financial statements as a whole, and in forming our opinion thereon. And we do not provide a separate opinion on these matters. This is the introductory para before writing any KAM, that it is in our judgment, these were the most significant in our audit of the current period. And then these were done or carried out as part of the audit. And then that we do not express a separate opinion on this. So this really clearly brings out the background for the key audit matters. There could be circumstances when key audit matters need not be communicated. This will be only extreme or exceptions where a particular law or regulation precludes from disclosure of the matter, because or it could be circumstances when it will be adversely affecting a particular company. So in all these matters where the auditor decides that there is a key audit matter, but he does not want to communicate, then he will have to exercise his judgment. And then if he has any doubts, or if there is any reason to believe that there is a doubt, or there are two views possible, then he has to probably seek a legal opinion on that doubt. Then also there could be possible that all the key audit matters are already covered under the qualification, or under the other paras, then he can merely say that he has already reported them under the respective paragraphs. Then there will be nothing to report under key audit matters. then there is a cross referencing required if there are three key audit matters, if it is mentioned under other paragraphs. And if he decides that there are no key audit matters, then he should say that there are no key audit matters. It is possible that sometimes there may not be any key audit matters, and he can say that there are no key audit matters. He will tell that only after he has communicated that to the board of directors. So this is the illustrative phrases which the institute has used when there are no key audit matters. We have to say that we have determined that there are no key audit matters to communicate in our report. This will be the language in the auditor's report if the auditor decides that there are no key audit matters. Or there are no key audit matters separately to be reported, but they are already included under other paragraphs, then he has to say that except for the matter described in the basis for qualified adverse opinion section or material uncertainty relating to going concern section, we have determined that there are no other key audit matters to communicate in our report. So all significant matters are already covered under qualification paragraphs or going concern paragraphs. Then if there is nothing else to report, then he can say that except for that there are no other matters. So in case there are key audit matters, in addition to matters which are qualified, for example there are four matters of which two are qualified and two are key audit matters. So the two matters will have to be reported under key audit matters. And this is the introductory paragraph that institute has suggested. Key audit matters are those matters that in our professional judgment were of more significance in our audit of the financial statements of the current period. These matters were addressed in the context of our audit of the financial statements as a whole and in forming our opinion thereon, and we do not provide a separate opinion on these matters. So this is the regular para which has to be given. There we have to further add, in addition to the matter described in the basis for qualified opinion section or basis for adverse opinion section, we have determined the matters described below to be key audit matters to be communicated in our report. So this is where he links up the 705 standard and 706 standard into 701. So now the key audit matters is required to be reported only by the listed company auditor. So now what happens in case of consolidation? The auditors of the components of the group, if they are not listed, they are not required to report KAM, key audit matters. For example, a company has two unlisted subsidiaries or has an unlisted associate or has an unlisted joint venture, then the auditor of that particular company, when he issues a report, he is not bound to give the key audit matters in his report. So there it will pose a limitation as far as the auditor of the main entity which is listed is concerned. So then we should communicate to that auditor in advance as required under SA 600, because he will have to use the work done by that other auditor. So he has to enter into plan, he has to plan and then enter into a clear understanding the other auditors that they give the key auditors matters as a separate report or as a separate document, so that the auditor can use the same in his consolidated report. So this is something on a case-to-case basis the auditor of a consolidating entity will have to consider at the time of planning itself. And then in the implementation guide, institute has tried to clarify many practical situations, which few of them I thought are relevant. We can go through them. One, the institute has clarified saying that when only the results are being audited and not the full-fledged financial statements, then in such case key audit matters is not required. Even though the audit report is issued, key audit will not apply if it is prepared only in pursuance of SEBI regulations. But as part of quarterly accounts, when the company prepares full sets of accounts and then publishes them, then there is no exception for that report, and then it is to be done for such companies. For example, some of the companies who have done and then published full-fledged accounts have already reported, the auditors of such companies have already reported key audit matters in their report, in the first quarter report for June 18. And then 701 also does not provide earlier option, but that is ruled out from the already in September. So earlier option is not possible. And that 701 will not apply where financial statements are prepared only for tax purposes, unless it's a general purpose financial statement. And then the listed companies or listed entities which the standard refers will refer to both listing which is done in India or outside India, and it can be of any security, it need not be only equity shares, it can be debt, debentures, it can be stock exchanges in India or outside India. So this is wide enough to cover all listings, whether in India or outside India, and any kind of securities. Then the Institute also has tried to clarify how key audit matters have to be done year on year, because this is a requirement that every year the auditor of a listed company will present key audit matters. So in a particular year, he has identified, say for example, taxation or disputed taxes as a key audit matter. So whether next year also he should report, he give a follow, or whether he should, whether that the same item should be reported as key audit matter, the Institute has clarified saying that that has to be independently seen. If they don't form a key audit matter for the next year, then the auditor is not required to report such key audit matters of the previous year. So it is possible that a disputed taxes may would have got resolved during this year, so it may no longer be a key audit matter in the current year. That is possible. But if the same item, if the same area of audit also becomes key audit matter for the current year also, then the auditor invariably will pick up the same area also for the current year.
If the valuation of stock has been the subject matter of key audit matter in the previous financial year, and the same opening stock has been carried forward, then again it becomes a subject matter of key audit.
It becomes a part of the closing stock also.
Yes.
If the auditor will have to spend similar time in understanding the valuation techniques, and if it is a material item and it's a high risk item, then it will be a key matter again. Because inventories of some of the inventory, in some kind of inventory, it's very technical, will require a lot of expertise, it will require a lot of quantification methodologies involved. For example, if it is inventory on a minefield where they are just excavated and then it is lying on the mine, in the mine, or it has come to the ground, but quantification of that is a huge exercise. And if that quantification is such a huge exercise where the auditor has to spend a lot of time, and he also has to look into a lot of expert reports, and if there are a lot of estimations involved in the valuation of that, it's a commodity.
It is a major impact.
Yeah, it is a major impact. Only then it will form a key audit matter. So it is possible that it's the same item may fall under key audit matter every year. For example, goodwill, if it's a major issue, it may fall part of key audit matter every year. So next clarification also, Institute is trying to indicate that if you follow the same risk assessment process every year, then what were the key risk areas of last year naturally will be key areas of current year also, but that need not be the same. It again depends on circumstances, and then this is where the rotation of the audit team comes into play, like what we saw in the previous video slide, where the junior auditor or the second auditor assumes a charge, then he starts looking at things differently. So if a particular partner has finalized the audit for 3-4 years and then he finds that these are the risk matters, but if a new auditor comes in, then he may always think that he may add one more or remove one more. So this is possible that some of the audit areas which were not considered as high risk, for example related party transactions, may not have been considered as a high risk, but when a new partner comes in, he finds that when the initial assessment was done, the number of transactions were limited, or the type of transactions were not complex, or the terms were not complex. So based on various aspects, the auditor who is looking at it for the second time may bring in related party transaction as a key audit matter or as a high risk item. So it is something to be evaluated each year, but in the normal course it should not significantly differ, because all these things require, we need to understand the practical aspects. All these things we have already communicated to the board of directors in the last year, saying that these are our key audit matters. Now current year, if you go back to them and then say that no, we are putting this additional ideas of key audit matter, you should be that much more clear you should be that much more articulate to say why it was not a key audit matter of a previous year, then how it becomes a key audit matter of a current year. So that requires a lot of planning and homework to be done to put across that point to the board of directors, saying that no, no, this is a key audit matter, we'll definitely look into at the planning stage itself.
Yeah, the second line. Yeah, so when we enter the audit we know. Yeah, there's always a management risk of overhead of controls. Yeah, yeah, but to prolong this we know, we may not be needing the audit report. No, here, 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 what happens is, you're right, but we spend a lot of time in verifying that. No, you agree, you agree that all the audit entries which are posted at the year end after the books are closed, everything is thoroughly checked two times, three times.
So that way, but can we give a certificate? We got about this, we attend this, but we didn't buy anything. No, no, in case of sales, see, sales and revenue are a major risk area which has to be addressed in an audit. Correct. And then having addressed it one or two years, you will come to a fair understanding of whether there are really uncertainties or it's always there. It's always there, you catch them, you rectify, you go ahead. I mean, especially the smaller clients.
Yeah. It's always there.
No, this we are talking about only listed companies.
Listed company even worse. Banks even worse. It's always there. A phone call.
The phone call is always there. This is the standard 240 itself presumes that there is a risk involved in something.
Yes.
There is a fraud possibility in the management override of controls or in the revenue area. What this game is only says that just because it is mentioned there does not mean that it will become a game. That's all. Just because it's a fraud area as far as 240 is concerned, does not mean that for KM it's an item for KM. For KM it has to go through the KM process. So it is not automatic. See, here to come to a brief background, here in the first year when it was introduced in UK, the auditors of UK reported this as a compulsory KM. The revenue and management override of controls, all the most of the reports of UK, they said that it's a mandatory because 240 requires that us to consider. But later they came back to say just because it is mandatory there does not mean that it has to form part of the key management, key audit matter. So when this was revised next year, and then in our standard also which Institute has brought about it, and then the implementation guide also very clearly says that those are matters for the purposes of audit planning and then doing the audit work. They may form part of a key audit matter, but they need not form part of a key audit matter. So the judgment has to be exercised whether it is really key audit matter. So that way, that we have passed through that stage which UK went through past 2 years. And that was the reason why the balance sheets of UK, most of the balance sheets of UK had at least 4 KMs. Whereas most of the others had 2 or less than 2. Because they had always these 2 as mandatory, they always felt that these 2 are mandatory KMs. That internationally also they have moved on. I think India starts with saying that it is not a mandatory kind of thing. You have to decide based on exercising the judgment. So to that extent, I think there is no overemphasis for the purpose of KM. Then the other question which a lot of people will have, is there any threshold? Can we report through KMs or can we report 10 KMs? Is there any limit? There is no limit. The standard very clear says, first says that there need not be any KMs depending on how you have judged. At the same time, they are not giving any upper limit also. In some circumstances, auditors may think that we have to report more KMs. They see the industry, other auditors have reported only 2 KMs or 3 KMs. So the auditor need not consider that there will be any limitations on the number of KMs. So he can have 4, 5, 6, whatever is required. Especially so if he thinks that issue may be only relevant for that year. If a particular issue is relevant only for that year, it is better that he reports in that year rather than leave it open. But at the same time, when there are more KMs, if there are 10 KMs, then the communication value may slightly come down because the auditor is not able to prioritize and then indicate which are the actual key matters, key audit matters. So auditor will have to weigh options to see whether some of them can be excluded, whether they are really material, can there be items which are material and more significant, 8 or 10 items, or whether only 2 or 3 items. So it depends on how the audit has progressed, because the audit progress is what determines what is a key audit matter. someone looks at their time sheets or someone looks at on what matters they are spending a lot of time, that will become very difficult.
Okay, we have got now generally about 15 to 20 matters.
Yeah.
Under regulatory requirements.
Yeah.
After that, what is left? I mean, if you look at it, it covers almost entire entire gamut of the, what should I say, balance sheet is covered in that particular thing. So what is left after that?
Correct. So what I'm saying is that, see, all this is when we actually go through the details only, we'll realize that this is a good development actually for the audit profession, where the auditor need not have anything in his working paper, he's putting it on record, he's putting it across to the board of directors, he's giving it to the shareholders, he's giving it to all the stakeholders. And then these are the items which will always get reviewed the next year, it will get reviewed by the industry peers. So this is a very good transparent and a progressive measure is what I think in terms of improving the audit quality.
Too much informing to the competitors and all this thing, because you are trying to see the key audit matter, a lot of details, how the each
are. So that is where you will have to exercise judgment, and then what language or words you use will be important. If you use a particular company name, customer name or vendor name, no one will like that. If you want to use a particular brand name or something like that, many of them may not like that. So you will have to see whether by describing it in a manner you will be able to put across. And most of the things we have to ensure that the management already reports this in the notes. That is why the planning becomes important. We should not have a scenario where the management has not commented it in the financial statement, but we will have to comment in KM. Those situations should be very remote. So that is why the planning becomes important. That we need to sit across, discuss with the management several points of time before the audit, during the audit, during the meetings, to see that our KMs are something which they will address it properly, they will disclose it properly, so that it is easier for us to put across our KM. Because the issues will be such that only such issues will come for KM. It will be only extreme rare scenario that you may not want to disclose. Only when there is a restriction under law that you cannot disclose such items, or it will adversely affect the client. So in those circumstances also you will have to seek a legal opinion that what you are thinking or what your views is correct. So in 99.99% of the cases, there will always be a reporting under the KM section. So we cannot visualize a situation where nothing is said in the financial statement that we put only in the auditors.
Then the reporting of KM to the board of directors can be more specific and detailed, and reporting in audit report can be more general.
Reporting to board will be of all significant audit matters, including matters arising from internal control. So there could be 10, 20 or 30 matters that we report to the board of directors. Out of that, we decide that 2 or 3 matters are key audit matters. So it is always better that at least what we report to the board is the same that what we are finally reporting to the shareholders.
The language to be used in the
language will necessarily be the same. Should be the same. Better that it is the same. You cannot increase it or expand the scope in the auditor's report without actually discussing with the board of directors. So as far as possible, if it is verbatim same, it is better. And then care also should be taken to, in when the KM is drafted, not to express an opinion on that KM issue. That is very important. That the institute is emphasizing time and again in many FAQs that auditor should not express an opinion on those matters. He has to merely communicate what processes he has undertaken for doing the audit area.
And does he add a comment whether he is comfortable with it? So if you just take goodwill impairment testing as an example. So the management followed XYZ processes. The auditor will also refer to that in his key audit.
Exactly.
And then finally he has to say he is comfortable with the management's assessment of the impairment risk or...
See, here the standard is very silent. He is only to describe the steps that he has undertaken, he is not required to express an opinion. But some of the examples I have seen where it is applicable, where it is available in public domain, where the auditor is somehow trying to give a conclusion. He is not saying opinion. He is trying to say conclusion that he has found nothing, which is he has not found any discrepancy. He is not saying that he is agreeing, but he is trying to say that there is no discrepancy. To that effect, there is a particular para or heading which some of the auditors are giving, which the standard does not contemplate. But probably this is also something which may evolve, but as of now it is not mandatory. But some of the auditors are giving as a conclusion.
If you put yourself in the shoes of a reader of a financial statement, I would say, okay, management has said what it has to say in the management report. As auditors, you are giving an auditor's report. So I see you have gone through this, you have elaborated, and then what? So
if it results in a modification, then you go to the basis of
it's just an awareness also as an investor or as a general reader if you are reading a statement.
So it depends on the particular scenario involved. The auditor can give some kind of a concluding note, but that note will not be to the point. It will be only to say that there are no discrepancies or...
For example, take the standard case of an assessment of sundry debtors. So you follow the list, management has and so on. So finally, the auditor agrees with the assessment of the management for provision of bad debts, or he doesn't, right? Basically, that's the conclusion.
Trade receivables, I just gave an example, but how far it will result in a KM unless it's a bank or a financial company is limited to. Because it's very factual. In the case of banks only, there is an estimation process of providing for debts. Whereas for non-banks, of course now with Ind AS there is a lot of estimation process involved. But there the chances are very less that it forms part of a KM. It may form part of a KM for a particular period where a particular debtor has been identified, where you don't get a lot of information, then you'll have to go based on management estimates. That will be very limited cases. But for financial institutions, provision for debts or provision impairment provision is a major item, and then it will forever it will be a KM only. So then the implementation guides also suggest how to arrive at a key audit matter. They are using what a model called as a funnel model. The funnel model is basically to put all the matters that you have already discussed with the management or not out in the management into that model. Then you will have to go to the next step to see whether which are the matters on which you have spent lot of time or attention, where the auditor has spent lot of time or attention, and then whether they were significant. There could be occasions where auditor would have spent lot of time and efforts but finally concluded that there is no issue there. That finally concludes that it is not material. So in such occasions, it may not fall in key audit matter, though he has spent a lot of time on it. But spending a lot of time is an indication that it's a key audit matter. And this is slightly detailing the requirements under communication with those charged with governance. So it starts with responsibilities of the auditor that has to be communicated to the board of directors, and then also plan, scope and timing of the audit including significant risk identified. So all this is part of the planning. The audit is supposed to communicate to the people charged with governance. So this will include plan for addressing significant risk of material misstatement, plan to address areas of higher assessed risk of material misstatement, approach to internal control, application of materiality. So here, in some of the audits, the auditor is so transparent that he is mentioning that this is my materiality. He mentions it to the board, he mentions it in the auditor's report also. And then he also says that this is how I quantify my materiality. This 5% of profit, or X percentage of assets, or X percentage of turnover, or it is a mix of them. Or some people report saying that I have taken average past 3 years profit and then I multiply this ratio of 5%, 10%. So this has become a lot more transparent now, how materiality is fixed. Either it is a model, or it is a percentage, or it could be a mix of assets, turnover, profitability. So since he is trying to disclose that in the auditor's report, he has to first discuss and then disclose to the board of directors. So some of these things are done at the planning stage itself. He is indicating that this is my materiality. And then in case he has to use any experts or specialized knowledge, that also he will communicate initially. And then preliminary views about matters that may be KM. These are all the things that the auditors will have to keep in mind on the reporting obligations in respect of a listed company, and then plan for it well in advance, so that the management or the board of directors are clearly aware that these are the issues which auditors will definitely address. Not only address, but communicate back to them, and then communicate to the shareholders. Apart from these things, the audit is also required to communicate on the independence. Earlier, the 360 has been amended now to say that the auditor will have to clearly communicate to the board of directors or the people charged with governance that they are independent. The team is independent. Not only that the concerned partner or the firm is independent, but the audit team is independent. The audit team is independent. And then also the fact that the regarding non-audit services, whether they have any extent of non-audit services, because under the Indian context, under the company law, they cannot do any non-audit services to the company. But the standard also contemplates that disclosure of non-audit services, not only by them, but by the network firms also. So it's a very comprehensive matters that has to be reported to the board regarding independence. And all these things will be asserted in the auditor's report saying that you are independent as per the code of conduct. Then matters that pose challenge to the auditor in forming an audit opinion. What could be the challenges that and appropriate evidence that he has to obtain? The challenges could be in understanding the business environment of the systems or IT systems or particular transactions, or it could be risk of material misstatement. Then presumed significant frauds, revenue recognition and management override of controls. This is something that he has to consider. These are the matters which normally attract a lot of auditor attention. Auditor spends time on these things. That is what we discussed earlier also, that these are areas that we spend a lot of time. Then where estimates are involved, where judgments are involved, or there are significant transactions or events which have happened in a year. Significant event could be an acquisition, significant event could be a sell-off transaction. So all this will require the auditor attention at a higher level, or it could be related party transactions. Then external factors, what could seriously impact a particular company. It could be exchange rates going up or going down, or commodity prices going up or down, how it will impact the particular company. These are matters which the auditor will take a lot more time to address these issues. And what are the other matters which go into determining significant or key audit matters? One is the auditor's judgment, size, complexity of the entity or the matter involved, or the areas that there have been depth, frequent or robust interactions with those charged with the governance on difficult and complex matters such as accounting estimation requiring significant management, judgment or appropriateness of an accounting policy. So this bullet point is what we saw through the entire morning presentation in the video, that there will always be audit matters where there will always be a lot of interactions with the government, with the people charged with governance and among the audit team. So these are matters which could be key audit matters. So then it also depends on accounting policies adopted. Then how important is that matter to the internet users? Then whether specialized teams have to be used or experts have to be used. Then if there are some difficulties in getting information or evidences, then it may end up in a disclaimer or a modified opinion. Then other matters, that's what I told earlier, that we should ensure that whatever matter is reporting under KM is also covered as a specific note in the financial statement so that it will be easy to communicate. For example, if there is no disclosure made also, the auditor is not absolved from disclosing the AM. So this happens when there is an issue relating to information systems or audits, where information systems, where under the financial statements presentation, there may not be any specific requirement to report such items. Or there is change in the internal controls or reporting hierarchy. So these are additional items that we'll have to ensure that the reporting under KM will be smooth. These are some of the examples of key audit matters. Certain complex areas relating to revenue recognition, provisions and contingencies, taxation matters, assessment of impairment, IT systems and controls, particularly when new software like ERP is implemented, valuation of financial instruments and derivatives. So, some of these areas the institute has brought out as an illustration in the implementation guide. So, I have captured that also in this PPT. If required, we can go through those illustrations also. They have two on revenue, two on going concern, and one on impairment. So, totally five illustrations are there. So, at least one or two we can go through if we have time. Then, of course, the auditor will have to maintain documentation for this game, how did he determine this game, what was the rationale for that. And then if he is deciding that something, there is no game to be reported, what is the basis for that. And then if he is not reporting something as game, he has to be very clear that something is not a game. Or the other issues that we discussed, that something which requires qualification cannot come as part of game. So he has to be very careful in documenting what are the games. This is one illustrative example relating to revenue recognition. The fact matrix is that this is a company which has lease rental income, and the lease rental income has comes from various business models, and then also the income recognition is based on the IT system that they have deployed. So the auditor here is considering that there is an inherent risk, because it is mostly system driven and each agreement may be complex for to study and determine the revenue recognition. So this, for most of the service entities which work on fixed price contracts or contracts which spread over more than 1 year, revenue recognition will always be a challenge, because the IT systems will have a lot of limitations in capturing the relevant information for revenue recognition. Because each agreement that the company enters into with its customers could be unique. And then each could be on a different model. In some cases, it could be purely per month basis. In some cases, it could be fixed amount. In some cases, it could get coupled with some other services. So, because of the complexity here, we could make out that the auditor has determined this as a key audit matter. Then how did he address this issue? So there, first they have read the accounting policies, internal controls, then they perform tests or controls assisted by IT specialists. So this is where the perspective of external expertise comes in, that they engage external or IT specialists to do that, to check whether the systems are in place. Then tests of control, then sample basis substantial verification, then whether all the assertions for a balance sheet, financial statement assertions are complied with or not. So this normally involves the other than traditional audit evidences. See, the traditional audit evidence, what normally we know, is a document or a physical verification or a confirmation, where lot of us are used to that, where the audit evidence is very simple in document form or we document it. But matters which normally come under KM are not these regular audit evidences. It could be, but it will always be in conjunction with something else. It will always be probably in conjunction with a IT system, or volume, or it could be in conjunction where lot of estimates are required, or there is a reliance on external valuation, or there is a management judgment involved. So that is where when these complexities are involved and when these are material, they become a KA. So here I just read out the para so that it will give the relevant essence. We perform test of controls assisted by our IT specialist over revenue recognition with specific focus on whether lease income is recorded over the lease terms on a straight line basis or other applicable basis as per the terms of the lease contract. We perform tests of detail on a sample basis to review the lease contracts entered into with the customers to assess whether lease income recorded is as per contract terms and also to identify any non-standard lease clauses and to assess the appropriateness of the lease income accounting. We assess the completeness of lease rental income recorded during the year through matching the data used in the revenue recognition to the approved lease agreements with the customers. We also perform detailed substantial analytical procedures of lease rental income and the timing of its recognition. So it is purely a descriptive manner of what were the audit procedures followed. So the audit procedures will always be a mix of many process, controls, testing of controls, substantial verification, then looking at the estimates. So, and then here nowhere the auditor is trying to express an opinion, he is only trying to assert what he has done. And the audit procedures clearly indicate that the test that he has performed is adequate for his financial statement assertion. Financial statement assertion will necessarily will have to include a cutoff assertion or a completeness assertion. It will have to include a valuation assertion. So many of these assertions he is taking care and then he is indicating this by putting this paragraph. Then this is the continuation of the same point. Regarding rent income calculated from lease turnover, we perform test of controls and match the workings to the reports received from leases and there will, and where no reports were available, we tested management estimates. For tenant incentives and guaranteed rent increases, we matched it to the lease agreements as per the sample and tested management estimates. So here nowhere there is an expression of opinion. It is only detailing the audit procedures adopted to indicate that the audit evidence that he has obtained is sufficient and appropriate. So this is one more on revenue recognition, where it is related to a container handling services where a throughput reconciliation is being done. Here they have given in the form of a bullet what are the audit steps followed. So this is one more way of presentation where they have clearly given bullet points for the audit procedures. What is testing controls, then calculations they have verified, then they have looked at operating records to see if financial records it is matching or not, tested revenue calculations and agreed the revenue recognized, check the bank advisors for credit notes. So this is various ways where the normal course the audit is performed. Those tests are getting reported to say that this is how it has been addressed. And then here also there is no conclusion, there is only a description of auditor's response. So here if you see the heading here is description of key audit matter and the next one is description of auditor's response. So there are only two parts in the KM. One is the description of the key audit matter and second is the description of the auditor's report, auditor's response. And many companies do present it in a tabular format, whereas the left side portion is the key audit matter and the right side portion is the description of the auditor's response, so that it becomes easy for someone reading the report. And then all the references to the financial statements would be done in the left part of it because he is drawing references, or it could be in the right side, right side also. So this way the reading becomes easier. Next one is on the going concern assessment, effect of volatility in precious metal prices. Here again they are talking about various steps in a bullet point format. Management's report to gain understanding of inputs and process underpinning the cash flow model prepared for the purpose of going concern assessment. So here basically they are looking at cash flow assessment, the budgeting process by walkthrough, the conversion of reserves and resources into data in to mine plans and production figures and by comparing actual realized cost levels to budgeted cost assumptions. So this is where some of this exercise is done every quarter or every year. This so the reserves that the reserves or the cash flows that he is considering every quarter, he can easily compare with what the management has given in the previous quarter. So he can compare that and then he can verify that that is consistently being done, or if there are reasons for change, whether the changes have been done. Then the last says that we have verified the cash flow model accurately reflects the approved 2017 budget and that the assumptions underpinning the 2018 cash flows are consistent with those in the 2017 budget. So the emphasis is on the word approved 2017 budget. So it means that it is approved by the board of directors or someone in the management. So that is where the sufficiency of the audit evidence comes in. Then further steps they have performed. So for key audit matters, generally it will not be just one audit evidence or one audit step they have done. It will be multiple of 3, 4, 5, 6, and sometimes it could be more than that also. Then the last one is on goodwill, where they are trying to describe how the goodwill is tested or impairment testing is done. Where they are talking about the number of cash generating units they have and what is the process they have followed.
Introducing.
Then they are trying to refer to the notes here. In this case, it's very clearly refer note number so and so for critical accounting judgments and key sources of estimation uncertainty, impairment losses, and intangible assets. So they are linking up all the notes relating to the accounting policies as well as relevant disclosures in the financial statements. And then this is how they have evaluated or carried out the auditor's response. They have evaluated the management's process, appropriateness of the management process, and then whether the control system in place, and then whether the model that they have followed is reasonable, and assumptions which they have followed are appropriate. Then testing the mathematical accuracy, then redoing the calculations, then checking that with the previous estimates done. So it's a whole lot of arithmetical or clerical processes which they are trying to recompute, recheck. But that is only one part of it. They are trying to check whether those parameters are in line with what they have done in the previous occasions or what the general market conditions are. So this is how that was one illustration. Then this is just to give an overall idea of which all countries have implemented the KM. UK has implemented it. Two Gulf countries and some African countries have implemented this. UK tends to have a large number of KMs. The top 10 matters that some of these companies in these countries are reporting are asset impairment, revenue, allowance for doubtful debt, goodwill impairment, taxation, investments, financial instruments, valuation of inventories, property valuation, and insurance. So, just trying to summarize the whole thing. This KM is something which will result in much more formal interactions with the people charged with the governments in terms of sending out the communications at the planning stage, during the audit stage, then post completion of the audit, so that the management understands the auditor's perspective upfront, and then relevant disclosures are made in the financials also. And then these KMs are always focusing on matters that requires judgment and estimates. And then this will also result in enhanced disclosures, of course, in the auditor's report as well as in the financial statements. So all this means is that the auditor's report becomes lengthier. It becomes lot more pages will get added into the auditor's report as well as into the financial statements. So this is a standard which is applicable for the first time, so all of us are looking at it for the first time. So as things develop, probably the benefits of this, the auditors or the corporates will start realizing. With these few words, I just end my paper.
Friends, it was a very interesting presentation. A very short time duration. Discovered the entire standard. Of course, I am very sure many more doubts will be there in our minds, how exactly this operates. If you have any questions, of course, you can pose them to the speaker.
Only question will be, if a certain item is not brought in the key audit matter, will it create a suspicion in the mind of the leader? For example, Satyam. Nobody thought about it. Till somebody asked, why was so much cash lying there? Okay. So, should cash have been a key audit matter? I mean, some of the...
See, in that case, cash would not have come under a key audit matter, it would have come as a qualification.
No. The fact is that the matter is not applied his mind, looked at cash at all as a key audit matter.
If the same process they were followed, if they identified, first of all, they should identify that as a high risk item. If an high risk item is involved, then it depends on the difficulties in getting the evidences. If there is difficulty in getting the evidences, and the auditor of the team has to spend a lot more time in discussing those with the management or with those staff requirements, that is very clearly key audit matter. So, if key audit matter, if this comes up in their documentation that they have spent a lot of time and attention for this, and it's a significant amount, definitely it would have come as a key audit matter. In those years. But if they have not spent a lot of time, then it cannot come. So that is the significance of it. Whether it resulted in interactions at various levels, like what we saw in the video, these interactions goes at so many levels over 2-3, it may happen over a 3-4 day period, but it goes up and down various levels between the team members, between the partners, between the team members and the audit committee, among the audit committee members, among the directors, then CFO is involved, CEO is involved, other audit committee members are involved. So these are issues which goes to that level, definitely then it will be a key audit matter. If it does not reach that level, then the chances of it being a key audit matter will be reduced. But in view of the size of the amounts involved, and then there is a requirement to formally communicate these things, now the chances are high that that those things may come to the fore. But the industry always holds lot of cash, the IT industry always holds lot of cash. That on a comparable basis, whoever looks at IT companies' balance sheet will always know that they are holding lot of cash. So from that perspective, from an industry perspective, it may not be that of a very high risk. But at the same time, like what we discussed earlier also, there is a change in partner rotation or someone starts looking at it, there is a new manager, if he feels that this documentation is not adequate, then those are triggers, and then those triggers will involve lot more interactions and lot more communications happening. That will result.
I think turning around this question, just because of the size of the item itself, and if it doesn't come as a key audit matter, it should not result in a question of auditor. So for example, like cash in bank, maybe if I'm the auditor, I think it's normal for the business, so I don't put it in key audit matters.
Yeah.
But somebody reading the report might just say, in absolute value, the cash in bank is so high, why it is not appearing in the key audit matter? So did the auditor really spend time and effort looking at it? So it should not mean...
That is where primarily the question comes up, whether the audit evidence he has gathered is sufficient and appropriate. If a junior person concludes that it is adequate or sufficient, and then it has not got triggered up, then it means that they have not spent sufficient time.
Shouldn't raise apprehensions on the quality of work that has been done, just because it doesn't come in the key audit?
Definitely it will raise issues. Because then it will signify the kind of audit evidence they have realized and then closed controlled.
Then what will happen is key audit matters will become very huge. Like everyone will put everything under key audit matters.
Exactly.
And it spoils the whole objective.
So that is where the judgment is required.
He is supposed to carry a particular limit of cash. If you are carrying at least for so many months to the higher thing, definitely.
See, you are supposed to carry a certain cash in the money. P&L you are not supposed to. If a company carries cash, we are much excess for a normal time. Definitely, you are making money.
Depends again on the amount involved, is that for a balance sheet or P&L, whether it is
material
or material. If it is material, then definitely it needs to matter. Because cash verification, how will he ensure, what part can he write in the key audit matter? He will have to comment on the controls, what is the control on a day-to-day basis, whether insurance is done, whether what is the documentation that someone is verifying it on a periodical basis, what is the verification he has done on 31st March to ensure.
Yeah,
so, 5 or 6 steps, he will definitely mention that on this basis only I have concluded that the cash balance exists. So, then it will become very clear. If he has not done a physical verification, if that step does not come into the key audit matter that he has addressed, then it is very clear that what audit steps he has done is not adequate. Then, if he is not able to do a verification, then there will be limitation. So, he has to bring out that limitation into the report. If he has to bring out a limitation into the report, that may result in disclaimers to that extent of cash. So, all this has a cycle of improving the audit quality and audit evidence.
Will I be wrong in saying that it is just an extract of my audit working paper?
Yes. Yes, it is to some extent, yes. But you'll have to present it to the whole world, so you'll have to be more careful, that's all.
Okay, so
you realize that when you go for tax assessments, you have seen this ledger, but if you have to give to tax officer, is it so simple to give that ledger?
And in addition also, there will be always a sort of tussle between the management, KMPs and the auditors on this. I mean, you would like to add many more things on the key audit matters. They may like you to drop certain things from the key audit matters. The whole idea is this is getting into your public reporting, finally. So this is available for the whole world to see. So naturally, I mean, if someone is engaging with you, whether it's a stakeholder like a revenue department is engaged with you, like income tax or GST, whoever it is, or someone who is trying to invest in your company, you will naturally go into these significant areas much more deeper than usual. So naturally there will be always a bargaining this one, why can't you drop these things? So there is a lot of judgmental issue wherein we had to sort of certain situations say yes, I had to put these in key of it, so I can't move.
Other point is, when we take it at a planning stage, why not we say these are the areas we'll have to put it in this thing?
Yeah, you indicate that as a preliminary or a tentative list of KM and then take it up to the board of directors or management.
Irrespective of whether, anyway we are not giving a conclusion there, it's a fact which has been...
No, but if other things come up, you cannot restrict
it. Anything is evolved during the audit process. Yeah. Like Satyam was mentioning, and you don't know really. Once you, Satyam, he was, Anil was mentioning. So,
today's that video was a very good presentation of how the audit process happens. So,
yes.
That is very clear that lot of interactions happen between juniors, between seniors, between client and auditor. So, that has been very captured very well in this. So, it becomes very easy to, those are the items which will be key audit matters.
Just taking off from this point, the mention of key audit matter, is it necessary that I have to mention my testing strategy there? Like we said in the beginning, it is part of the planning stage and we identify this is my key audit matter. So in the end when I come there, I can just mention, okay, like we saw in your illustrative slides, revenues of key audit matter. Do I have to actually go in and say, okay, this was tested, this is how we tested it?
Exactly.
So it's compulsory that I actually go into my testing strategy
exactly,
and explain.
Exactly. But to what extent, in what language it will be done, it will be an evolving thing. But you will have to clearly mention how you address the audit risk or address the audit area. So, to what language it is used may undergo a change, probably how other people start reporting and then to what extent, whether 4 steps are enough or 8 steps were required. Because by writing that, you should be able to communicate to the reader that you obtained adequate and sufficient audit evidence. The words that you use, that one evidence is never adequate for any of these areas, it always be multiple. Audit processes which will be done, it will be consultations with external experts or internal experts, it will be test of IT, it will be test of assumptions, it will be test of management intentions or so it will never be one or two. See, that is why these things come up as audit matters.
Yeah, friends, we really run out of time and you may have some more questions, so probably you can have it offline. So let us conclude the session. In the beginning, Assistant Chairman Nityananji mentioned the importance of the standards on auditing, to perform the audit assignment and to meet the expectation of the stakeholders. So let us thank the Nityananji for his presence and his valuable time, and wish you wisdom, sir. Thank you, sir. Our speaker Srinivas made a detailed presentation of SA701 and key audit matters. I think all of you enriched your knowledge. Please thank the speaker with a round of applause. Time to present a memento to speaker and to our present chairman. May I request our past chairman, Anil Kumar, to come forward and do the honor. No, it is, sir.
The way
wrong. Please thank you. Please stand, speaker, the round of applause. Thank you, Anil Kumar. Friends, let us break for lunch and reassemble by 2 p.m. for our third technical session.